I want to welcome you to the Sunday after Easter. You know, I was, I'm foggy on the details. You guys will probably tell me that I'm explaining this wrong, but I think a lot of churches over the years have had a thing on the week after Easter called, I think it was Bright Sunday, where I was explaining it to the team. I think it was kind of like Easter without all the high pressure Easter stuff. If I'm completely making that up, then I apologize. But it's still kind of cool if you think about the fact that we are a week after Easter. And Easter, although the Easter Sunday happened, now we're just getting to live in the post-resurrection world. And it's kind of fun that, like, every Sunday now, we're in the Easter after, the season after Easter. All the way until we get back to the start of Lent next year, where we go back into the pre-cross mode. It's just a fun thing to do. So I say this morning, as we sing, we've got some really cool songs this morning. One new one that I think you're going to really, really like. Ian gets to talk to us this morning. I encourage us all to enter into our worship today just with that excitement that we are living lives post-Easter, post-resurrection, in the season of eternity with God. So let's have that in our spirit as we sing. Let's do it. Sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope, there's no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in, when death was arrested and my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given a name. Morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. And oh, your grace so free washes over. Your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom faithfully. My dead, and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. And our Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven was lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. Everybody, have a seat.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Eagle Church this post-Easter Sunday. The tomb's still empty. Didn't we have a great Easter weekend together? Wasn't that great for those of you who were here? I never had so many people offer to empty the trash after the service last Sunday. And if you don't get what that means, you can watch the service from last week. But welcome to all those joining us online as well. It's always great having our online community. You've got a host there to help you stay connected as well. And we had an estimated 400 to 500 guests with us over the past 2 weekends. Isn't that great? Can we put our hands together and welcome all of our guests? Maybe you're here today and just been coming from Frank Reich Sunday or Easter Sunday. We're glad to have you a part of a regular Sunday around here. And we just want to point out some ways you can take some next steps with us. And one of those is next Sunday, right after service, if you'd like to hang out and have lunch with myself and a couple other leaders at the church, we're going to have a membership lunch. Doesn't require you to be a member, but we'll feed you some free Qdoba lunch. That usually gets a good crowd there. So we'll hang out for an hour, hour and a half or so. We'll answer some questions, talk about vision and values of the church. If you'd like to be a part of that, would you let us know that you're coming so we can plan food and childcare appropriately? You can just eaglechurch.com/events, or you can write it on your communication card there that you received in the bulletin, and you can place that in the offering at the end. That's next Sunday right after service. And today, right after the worship service, we've got a meeting out in the atrium for the Sicily mission trip that's happening this fall. So our mission partner in Italy, there's a team going over this October. It's an informational meeting, 11:45 today. So after the service, if you want to hang out in the atrium, there'll be some folks there to explain a little bit more about what they'll be doing and what that team's about, and that'll be a good next step for you as well. We've got a guest central area out in the atrium as well. If you're newer, you can get a gift bag. We've got some free stuff to give you out there as well. And this past Wednesday, we had like men's and women's classes going on Wednesday night. That's been a great next step for a lot of people. So we had over 170 adults show up on Wednesday night, which has been a great next step, just kind of becoming more connected. So we want to connect with you. And if you've got questions about who we are, if you'd like to know next steps, you can use your communication card, download the app, go on the eaglechurch.com website. There's a lot of places there for next steps. And if you go to the /events page, that'll help you as well. Well, it's a special day for us as a church because we're going to dedicate three of the newest members of the Eagle family. So let's put our hands together and welcome three families to the stage, dedicating their babies today. We've got the Estridge family, the Martin family, and the Saucerman family. And as they make their way up here, one of the reasons this is an important step for us as a family is we want to publicly recognize the work of God going on in the generation. So as around here, we like to say we're about three things: discipleship, missions, and next gen. So the next generation ministry, no better visual of that than what you're seeing before you today. And so the fruit of what's happening here is an investment from many of your lives who serve in children's ministry and student ministry and adult ministry. So you guys slide over here onto this carpet area there. That'll help. You guys slide on this end here. Isn't this a great visual? So I want to welcome. I'm going to start with the Estridge family here. So Chris and Mackenzie, why don't you introduce to us little Sterling and tell us a little bit about this guy. No, you got your mic right there.
All right. This is my beautiful wife, Mackenzie, and I am Chris, and this is our soon-to-be five-month son, Sterling Tatum Estridge. And told myself I wasn't going to do this. he is named after his grandpa, Bob Sterling, and as God's timing is always perfect, this little guy came at a very perfect time for our family. We found out a year ago, last Easter, that we were pregnant with him, and he's been a blessing ever since.
How about the, you guys want to talk about the scripture you chose and the verse you have for little Sterling?
All right. So the verse we chose is a fitting verse. After Bob passed away, we lost his wallet, and when we found it, miraculously, scripted on the wallet was the verse of Isaiah 40, Isaiah 40, verse 31, and it says, "But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint."
So, guys, I think about the journey of the difficult endings that have gone on in your lives the last couple of years, and I think about Bob's season ticket seat right there with the rest of your crew, right? He was always seated there on the aisle, and I thought about all the times he was filled with tears when he would see the family stand up here and dedicate kids and how he just loved his heart for children, his heart for the Lord, and you chose his name to help reinforce a new beginning that Sterling brings for your family. And we as a congregation, we rejoice. Bob served as an elder here at the church for a number of years. He was involved in so many different ministries, blessed and touched so many people. But to have his life physically taken away at the age of 58, as you can imagine, the wave of ending for this family. And then on the backside of that, to see little Sterling here before you can see the joy that Sterling brings in this journey of new beginnings. So can we put our hands together in dedicating Sterling? Martin family, introduce yourselves to us, please.
Hi, I'm Libby, and this is my husband, Aaron. This is 5-year-old Graham and 3-year-old Cooper, and pushing 8-month-old Robin. So when we were young and naive and just married, we talked about how many kids we wanted to have, and you know, I was like, I want like 4 or 5, you know, and Aaron said, how about 1 or 2, and then we had Graham, then we had Cooper just 18, 19 months later, and Aaron said, I think 2 is good, and we agreed that when Cooper turned 2, we could have the conversation again, because we were still really underwater. So on Cooper's 2nd birthday, we went for a walk, and I had been praying that God would either change my heart or his heart, because I still wanted that more babies, and pretty quickly he said, yeah, let's do it. Let's have our 3rd and final installment.
So, is it 3 and final? Is it really final, Aaron? Are you 3 and done?
Yeah, 3's good.
3's good.
So, ever since Robin was born, she has been our little socialite. As soon as I went back to work, she was pretty difficult at home. Like, I was always having to, like, entertain her, bounce her around, and then I sent her to daycare, and the daycare lady said, this is just the easiest, sweetest baby I've ever met, and I was like, what? And it turns out she just loves being around her people. She loves being just, she's a social baby, loves to smile. So, and we named her Robin Harvey to honor both of our families. My mother's maiden name is Harvey, so that side of the family is Harvey. And Aaron's grandfather, his first name was Harvey. So we chose Philippians 4:13 for her verse. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. She comes from a long line of strong women, and we get all of our strength from the Lord. So.
Let's put our hands together for the Martin family. Thank you. Saucermans, Brent and Mandy.
Good morning. I'm Mandy. This is my husband, Brent. And this is little baby Monroe Anthony. And he was just adopted last week. He was born April 12th. And our verse is Psalm 25:1. In you, Lord, my God, I put my trust. And the reason we chose that verse is we just went through a failed adoption before getting him. And we were on our knees a lot reciting that verse for about 9 days consistently, waiting on the other situation. And long story short, we flew home, and less than 24 hours after we got home from the first situation, we got a call from our caseworker that this little guy had been born at a hospital in Phoenix. We were working with an agency in Arizona, and he needed a home. So we were still kind of half-packed. So we decided to book another plane ticket, and we took off and got him. So, again, that verse was our prayer, but it's also our prayer for his life, that he would learn through us and through his church family to just always trust God. And hopefully his story is a good example of how that's what you got to do.
What a journey. So literally this past Monday is when you received Monroe, is that right?
Yes, the 15th.
And you came to Indiana when? When did you get in town?
We got back home Friday night about 1 a.m.
So how about that? So little Monroe just brought into the state of Indiana. Isn't that a beautiful picture? Like, think about the story Monroe's going to have to tell one day, right? That a couple who wanted to kind of display Christ's love by receiving in those who don't have a home and would step into the adoption process. And if you want to learn more about that journey, Brent and Mandy have an awful lot that the Lord's been teaching them through it. Because if those of you who've been through it know, it's filled with a lot of ups and downs. It's not been the easiest road, but consistently you saw, hey, the Lord has this for us, and the winding road that it's been, and here you stand with Monroe, believing this is God's choice for your lives, and we rejoice with you. So how about put our hands together for little Monroe and their family as well. He's doing great. So before I pray, guys, I just want to share a couple of words under the banner of rightly ordered loves. So my charge to you guys on this day is what Augustine said, that there are rightly ordered loves of the heart. And the temptation is when you receive a child, especially from some of the journey that you guys have had with the waiting and the longing to have a child, and then you, the waiting and longing for adoption, and then even the surprise of number three and what a gift it is to have children. The temptation is that the children become the center and they occupy an elevated love that God never intended, right? That Jesus said our first and foremost love was to be the Lord. Love the Lord with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. The primary way these children are going to learn how to walk with God is watching you. That should keep you on your knees for a while, right? That's how they're going to learn how to pray and trust God and believe him for big things and trust him in the question marks. They're going to watch you do that. How are they going to learn how to worship God? They're going to watch you do that. And so the first and primary love of your heart is to be the Lord and to keep that at the top of the stack. And then secondly, it's your love for one another. To remember, hey, mom and dad, it was mom and dad before it was them. And sometimes you kind of lose sight of that, right? It's easy to forget that the children, right, can begin to occupy so much of our time and energy that we lose the gift that we've been given in each other. So rightly ordering the loves of loving the Lord, loving one another, and then out of that love, you have what's given for these children. And so in that, I just want to pray a blessing over you. And to help do that, I'm going to ask all those who've come to support you to stand up. So if you're here, friend, family, life group member, class, table leader with them, he's doing great. Don't worry about it. He's fine. Little Sterling just wants to be a part, just wants me to give him the mic and all that. Huh? Do you want anything? Are you good?
Run me a bottle.
Mackenzie wants a bottle, so we'll work on that. So the visual I want you guys to have here is look at all these folks who are standing to say you're not alone in this, right? Mom and dad, sometimes on the journey, it can feel exhausting. You can feel like you're at the end of yourself. You can wonder how you're going to get through this next stage of whatever development cycle the kids are in. But this is a group of people standing to say, hey, you can always lean into us. Thanks, Jacob. Appreciate it. Sterling's going to thank you. He came in, all right. He's just a little under the weather. He's just like his dad, though, always looking for a good meal. So just like dad, right? That's great. But the picture I want you to have is a visual that you aren't alone in it, and that it's this group of people who are committed to help you keep rightly ordered loves. And we're in it for the long haul. And we're rejoicing with you that we get to see these kids grow up and walk with the Lord all the days of their life. So let's have the rest of us stand, and we're going to pray a blessing on these. Lord Jesus, thank you for these lives who are before us. Psalm 139 says, these children are fearfully and wonderfully made in your sight, knit together, known and ordained by you each day, Lord, before one of them comes to be. And I think of little Sterling here, and I think about the journey for this family, and I thank you for the joy he's already bringing to mom and dad and to the extended family. And I pray for a measure of healing grace to ripple out through Sterling's life. I pray that joy would radiate from the countenance of this young man, and that he would grow up, much like it said in 2 Timothy 1. Timothy said his faith lived in his grandmother Lois and in his mother Eunice and now lives in him. And I think about that with Sterling. The faith of grandparents and now parents and now passed on to him. And so may he grow up to live into the full measure of his name and represent what it means to love you with all his heart, mind, soul, and strength and to love people. We pray your blessings on him. We thank you for Robin. We thank you for the joy that Robin is and for the gift it is to be the third child in this household. I thank you that your plans and purposes, Lord, for her. I think of Psalm 144 when I think of Robin, that daughters are like pillars carved to adorn a palace. And I pray that over her in this household, that she would radiate your life, Lord, to her siblings and to this household, this family now of five. May the fullness of your blessing rest upon them. May Robin grow up to love you with every fiber of her being, that you'd be the deepest love of her heart, we pray, and we thank you for the gift that she is. And Jesus, for Monroe, what an amazing picture of Ephesians 1, Lord, that we've been adopted by your Spirit and through the blood of Christ into your family. And I thank you that Brent and Mandy now are displaying that kind of love by adopting Monroe. I just think of the beautiful image that is to be grafted into a new family. And we just pray the fullness of your blessing on Monroe as he grows up, that he would grow to love you and walk with you and listen to your voice and hold fast to your ways. I think about him running around all the children's classes and eventually in student ministry and going off to Ignite Camp. And I just think about the story, Lord, that you're going to write in this young man's life that started this past week in Arizona with a twist and a turn that could only be the work of grace. And so we just ask your blessings to rest on Monroe all the days of his life. May he live into the full measure of being adopted into the family of Jesus. And Lord, for these parents, for Chris and Mackenzie, for Aaron and Libby, for Brent and Mandy, Lord, parenting can just be so exhausting. It just brings us to our knees. And I ask you to fill them with your Spirit afresh. Give them what they need every hour, every day, to keep the ways of the Lord before these kids. Help them to love you with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength. Help them to depend on you. Teach them how to pray as mom and dad. And then help them to love one another. I pray this would be a season in their marriage when their love for each other would grow deeper still. And then, Lord, they just need a lot of wisdom when it comes to decision-making and discipline and how to raise up kids to walk with you and serve you and navigate all that this world throws at them. So I ask you to bless these families, bless these parents, bless these households. I pray that when people get around the Estridge and Martin and Saucerman families, they'd walk away and conclude, surely the Lord is with them. We ask it in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, amen. One final round of applause for this crew. Congratulations, guys. You just needed that bottle. That's all he needed. Congratulations on their way out. They have a certificate, and they've got like a first Bible for the kids as well. And just to support them in their spiritual growth and development. Worship team, no greater setting to worship on the heels of that, right? New life entering in.
The King above all kings. shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice. Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross.
Free. before you. We thank you. We thank you for Christ alone, our cornerstone. God, that through the storm, that you are with us. Be with Ian as he brings your word today. Fill him with your spirit. We thank you for this time. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, my name is Ian, and I'm the student pastor here at Eagle Church, and I am very excited for this morning. And I wanted to actually just start so that you could hear from me how grateful I am to get to do life with this church. It's been just over 4 years since I moved here. And since then, I found this place to be such a joy-filled place of community. It's been a growing season for myself. I'm not the same person that I was when I moved here, and I'm so grateful for that. It's been a place of healing, and so I just want you guys to know that I'm grateful and thankful for who you guys are as a church in my life. Well, since so much of today is in light of Easter, I actually wanted to show a quick video to give you a little insight into what goes on in the minds of pastors around Easter. Now, most Christian comedians are not funny, but this guy that you're going to see is hilarious. And see, Pastor Eric, he loves to bring kind of the Gen X humor, right? Do you see what I'm saying? Like, he brings that middle-aged humor to the church, and I thought, okay, well, we're going to young it up in here. We're going to bring the millennial humor forward. So take a look at this video. It's called Pastors on Easter.
Okay, everybody, listen up. This is Easter. Shuttles and golf carts in the parking lot. Now, has everyone in here, staff or volunteer, shared our graphically designed Easter invitation on their personal Instagram? This is for the kingdom. Who is trimming these hedges? A youth intern? For heaven's sakes. And connect cards, connect cards, connect cards. Do we have the right mixture of haze in the fog machine? I mean, we don't need new members, but did we get the rose petals in the visitor parking spaces? We are pro-Jesus and pro-Easter Bunny. Donuts. Check. Coffee. Check. Make sure we have gluten-free communion, fat-free communion, Whole30 communion, vegan communion, paleo communion, non-GMO communion. Honestly, everybody needs to keep their phones out because I will be saying some very tweetable quotes this morning. The Easter basket is full, but the tomb is empty. This is Easter. No, the youth pastor cannot do announcements. We don't want any visitor to feel uncomfortable in any way at any time, but we will ask them to fill out a connect card with their children's names and ages. Why would you even ask about the worship set list? It's Jesus paid it all, Christ alone, Christ is risen. This is the best great team we have. Who trained these people? For one Sunday, please, can you just not be weird? Make sure all the visitors know that they are under no pressure to give, okay? But we'd love to see them come back, and if they do come back, we're starting a series on giving next week.
I know, it's like shameless plug for John Chris. He's hilarious. And don't worry, we are not starting a series on giving this week. So back to the task at hand. We've been in John, and all through March and April, we were walking through Lent. So we had our one-day wall where people could put up prayer requests, big asks of the Lord, that one day God would answer them, right? And one day he would intervene and intercede. We've seen some amazing answers to prayer. We also have plenty of people who are still in that season of waiting. Then it's Good Friday, and we come together, we remember, we reflect, and we consider what is it in our sin that, you know, put him on the tree, and what did our God suffer on our behalf? But then it was Easter Sunday, right? And Easter is amazing. You know, people sing out on Easter Sunday. Like, we got to sing out like that all year because it's just people are excited. Jesus is alive. Death is defeated. The stone is rolled away. But sometimes after Easter, we then fall into something that I like to call the Easter fizzle. It is kind of like what happens when you eat an entire bag of Peeps all by yourself. Now, don't act like you haven't done it. Peeps are amazing. But the Easter fizzle is kind of like that because the Easter fizzle is what happens when we choose to do the wrong thing with a good thing. So Peeps are amazing. Heavenly even, but we can choose to do the wrong thing with them. We can choose to open them too early before they are properly crisp, right? To eat. My dad taught me well. Or we can choose to do the wrong thing with our Peeps by eating an entire box of them all by ourselves, which then we regret, and the people around us on Easter dinner also regret it. Easter is a really good thing. I know it is amazing that they let me get up here and say profound things like that. Easter is a really, really good thing, but we can choose to do the wrong thing with it, and that's where the Easter fizzle comes in. So last week, I bet if you were here, you left this place like so excited, so encouraged, and refreshed. You're feeling the blessings of the Lord. But if our excitement from Easter doesn't lead us to tell everyone about Jesus, then we fizzle. If our encouragement from Easter is based more in a feeling than in the resurrection power of Christ, we will fizzle. And maybe if we were viewing Lent as more of a spiritual booster shot instead of as another opportunity to be that much more in step with the Spirit, then we fizzle out. Thankfully, on the very first Easter Sunday, Jesus tells us what we need to avoid the Easter fizzle. He tells us what we need so that we don't go through a whole nother year, year after year, without being able to point to anything that can't be explained by just saying, like, that's a God thing. So that's where we'll be this morning, and I want to invite you guys to pray with me now. The goal is that myself and everyone who's up here, we fade away so that we can just hear from the Lord. So pray with me towards that end, and we'll jump in. Heavenly Father, we come to you because you alone are worthy of praise and adoration and worship. Lord, we know that you are the God who speaks to us. So Lord, we ask that on this side of Easter, would we be able to focus and hear clearly from you, what are you inviting us into, so that we could be just this community that is so filled up by you that it changes everything. So towards that end, we pray. Lord, I ask that you would give us ears to hear, but also that we wouldn't just be hearers of the word, but then doers as well. So I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you'd like to join me, we're in John 20. This is the last week we'll be in John, and we're going to start in verse 19. You can follow along with your own copy. I'll be reading out of the ESV. You can also read up on the screens. But briefly, just to set the scene, it is still Easter Sunday, and Christ has just appeared to Mary Magdalene. So this is verse 19. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." So Easter happened. How do we avoid this Easter fizzle? Well, first, by being filled with the Spirit. There is a massive shift taking place in John 20, because in the Old Testament, the Spirit existed, but Spirit indwelling was permanent, or was temporary. You know, it would come and go. So what Jesus is doing is this massive shift, and I think we can understand this as a preview, a literal precursor of what's to come in Acts 2 when the Holy Spirit falls on the believers at Pentecost. For those of us living now, we live always on the other side of Acts 2. So when we receive Jesus for the first time, we have the Spirit. Ephesians 1 tells us that we believe in the Lord, and we're sealed with the promise. That promise is the Holy Spirit. So to just like set the stage for us, if you are one here who does not yet know Jesus, man, like I would love for that to happen this morning, because that is the first step. And Pastor Eric gave a crystal clear gospel presentation last week that Jesus, fully God, fully man, came, he died on the cross, rose again 3 days later to pay the penalty for our sins. If we put our faith in him, then we receive him and we receive the Spirit. So that is step one. But probably for most of us in this room who know Jesus, we have the Spirit, but sometimes we are not filled with the Spirit. Maybe you relate. Maybe you know Jesus, but you just lack peace. Or you come over and over again on Sunday mornings, listen to sermons, but you cannot find joy. Perhaps you're feeling that conviction that, man, I need to live more openly as a Christ follower in the workplace, but I can't find the courage. Or, you know, the kid who knows Jesus and goes for years and years, but simultaneously has that secret sin struggle, that sin issue. That's what it kind of looks like for us, as we are having the Spirit but not being filled with him. So Easter brings this hope for something more. Dwight L. Moody, renowned evangelist of the 19th century, was said to have a campaign in England. An elderly pastor protested, "Why do we need this Mr. Moody to come here? He's uneducated, inexperienced. Who does he think he is anyway? Does he think that he has a monopoly on the Holy Spirit?" But another, wiser pastor rose and responded, "No, he doesn't have a monopoly on the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit has a monopoly on Mr. Moody." That monopoly that the Spirit had on Moody, that is what being filled is like, right? So sustained supernatural joy, victory over sin, boldness in witness, effectiveness in ministry, that is what it is to be filled. D.L. Moody himself said, and you can read this in the notes or on the screen, "I believe firmly that the moment our hearts are emptied of pride and selfishness and ambition, the Holy Spirit will fill every corner of our hearts. But if we are full of pride and conceit and ambition and the world, there is no room for the Spirit of God. We must be emptied before we can be filled." So Jesus keeps it real simple on that first Easter Sunday, right? Breathes on the disciples, fulfills John 14, and says, "Receive the Spirit, be filled with the Spirit." You might think, well, like, how does that happen? I think a big part is asking, praying repeatedly, pursuing the Spirit, obedience in things big and small. That's the how. I think as I was preparing for this message, it hit me that I've had some experiences that are like that, you know, seasons of joy, being able to respond to a prompting from the Spirit, maybe when I'm convicted of my own sin, or when I know, oh, God wants me to share part of my story to minister to someone, and you offer that word from the Lord. Or maybe you don't know what to say, and you know that, oh, God stood in the gap for me, like he carried me along, like he carried along the Old Testament prophets, and he spoke for me. Those are those experiences that I've had some of that, we've probably had some of that, but I want more. And Francis Chan, one of my favorite pastors, he writes, "Christ said it is better for us that the Spirit came, and I want to live like I know that is true. Christ said it is better for us that the Spirit came, and I want to live like I know that is true." Like, I want to live like I know it's true. So Easter Sunday, we avoid the Easter fizzle by being filled with the Spirit. Another thing you see is we avoid the Easter fizzle by being about the mission. So Jesus said to the disciples in the passage, "As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." So Jesus is sending all of his disciples, present day and back then, to join him in this mission. Now something changed, right? Something shifted for the disciples because they went from being pretty lame-o, cowardly followers to all of a sudden being willing to follow Jesus even to the point of death. What changed was Resurrection Sunday. They saw it and it changed them. You might have caught something in the text that was a little bit confusing, so why don't you look with me at verse 23 in John 20. Jesus says, if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. I don't know about you, but is that confusing? Like, I read that probably a couple weeks ago when I started prepping, and I was like, I don't get it. I don't know how to explain it. What am I going to do? So, of course, you get into your commentaries, you're asking people. And I was wrestling with, why does it seem that Jesus is saying that we as people have the power to forgive sins when we know from other parts of Scripture that that cannot be true? The context is going to clue us into what it means. So you and I do not have the power to forgive sins, but we do have the power to announce forgiveness. We do not have the power to forgive people's sins, but we do have the power to proclaim forgiveness. I put this in your notes. There's a theologian, Merrill Tenney, who explains this so well. God does not forgive sins because we decide to do so, nor withhold forgiveness because we will not grant it. We announce it, we do not create it. This is the essence of salvation. And all who proclaim the gospel are in effect forgiving or not forgiving sins, depending on whether the hearer accepts or rejects the Lord Jesus. So, if I present the gospel to a student at Starbucks, because we all know that the Holy Spirit lives and works best at Starbucks. If I'm presenting the Holy Spirit to a student and the student receives the gospel, accepts Jesus, then I can tell them, your sins are forgiven. I didn't do it, right? I did not create it, but I can tell them that. In the same way, I present the gospel to a student and the student rejects it. Then I also can say, unfortunately, your sins are not forgiven because you are rejecting the one thing that would make it possible. We avoid the Easter fizzle by being about the mission, and that mission is the proclamation of the forgiveness of sins to everyone. I like interaction in sermons, so you have permission to raise your hand if you feel so led. Have you ever been bored in church? If your hand is not raised, you're a liar. It's okay. We all know those times. And here's the thing, right? I think church can be boring because people make it boring. But God is not boring. I'm pretty convinced that at the long list of things that God does not really care for, probably at the top of it is boring church services. Because we can make him boring. God is not boring, and his mission is absolutely not boring, right? So if we get bored in our lives after Easter, which I know sometimes happens, maybe it's because we are just no longer about his mission. We made it about our mission. And I get this way too often. I will start to get caught up in my goals, my plans, my accomplishments. And those things do satisfy for a little while. If they didn't satisfy, no one would fall for them. Money, comfort, status, accomplishment, those things will work for a while, but after a while, it is so boring. We get bored because we are not doing the mission that God invited us into. So I don't normally get to use sports illustrations because I don't follow sports. So it doesn't come across very naturally. I'd rather pull an illustration from a musical and run with that. But thankfully, Coach Frank, who was here 2 weeks ago, he gave me a sports illustration. Coach Frank, who's the head coach for the Colts, he said something profound. He said that at a point in his life, he had to decide if he was going to be in ministry by going into a formal ministry role or if he was going to be in ministry by going into the NFL. That is being about the mission. Like, Coach Frank gets it. He knows that the best thing that he can do with his one life is to proclaim the forgiveness of sins to everyone. It's also just hitting me now that that still wasn't really a sports illustration, but that's okay. It's fine. There is always something to do, someone to serve, someone to disciple, someone to pray with, somewhere to go, a mission trip to go on. And thankfully, also, there is always time to spend with the Lord, lest we think that this is a message just about doing a bunch of things. It is not. We spend time with the Lord so that we are filled up as we go into the mission. But there is always something to do. We cannot get bored because there's so much to do. So we avoid the Easter fizzle by being about the mission. Lastly, would you reread with me? We're going to still be John 20. It's verse 25 all the way through verse 28. So the other disciples told Thomas, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails and place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Thomas was always the guy who wasn't afraid to ask questions. Back in John 11, Thomas was the guy who even said he would be willing to die with Jesus. So when I look at this passage, I see some things about Thomas. First, when I see Thomas, I see someone who wanted the same experience as the other disciples. They had had visible proof of Christ's resurrection. He had not yet. And he simply wanted the same thing. I know that when I see God do something in or for someone around me, I often want the same thing. And while it may not be the best motivation, that is not a bad desire. It is not a bad thing to be in the family of God and say, like, "Oh man, what God is doing there, like, I want in on that. I want to see it myself. I want to experience it." When I look at Thomas, I see someone kind of like the psalmists. Have you ever read in the Psalms and been maybe a little surprised by how abrasive and bold the psalmists are and how they talk with the Lord? I think Thomas is like them. He is not afraid to speak up. He's not afraid to make demands of the Lord. And I think what's great is that God can, of course, cope with that. He would much rather hear from us, even if we say something silly, instead of what we probably too often give, which is the indifference or the apathy or the distractions. When I look at Thomas, I see someone also who is willing to change. Now, this idea that I'm going to share with you, as I was prepping, I shared it with a couple of friends and got some pretty strong pushback. But after we came full circle, we were like, "Oh, this is good." So bear with me while I try to explain this. It doesn't actually say in the text that Thomas touched Jesus. We often assume that he did. We have probably sat under sermons that told us he did. But not only does the text not say that, but the argument against is stronger because of what Jesus says in response to Thomas. All Jesus says is, "You believe because you have seen me." Why bring it up? I want us to consider that, is it possible that Thomas thought he knew what he needed from the Lord, but when he was confronted with the living Christ, he realized he already had everything that he needed? Is it possible that he had a demand in mind for the Lord? "I need you to do this." But when confronted, like he saw Jesus and Jesus is talking to him. So when confronted with the living Christ, he realizes, I already have now everything that I need. Some of us are insisting that God will show up in our lives in a certain way. Maybe it's that job or promotion. Like, God, if you just gave me that, it's good. The unruly child where you're like, man, if I just had a season of obedience with the kid, like, it would be great. Or maybe, and I think this is probably what's most common, we demand of the Lord, Lord, if you could just give me a sense of significance. Like, I just want to matter. I just want to have a satisfaction in my life right now. If you give me that, then we're good. What would happen if a bunch of us, holding on to these demands of the Lord, were instead confronted anew with the living Christ, realizing that we have everything that we need? We tell God that we know what's best. We think we know what God should give us. But what Thomas did is he was willing to change, a change of mind, a change of heart. And he was willing to do that. You know what believing like Thomas looks like? It looks like 90-plus women and 70-plus men meeting together here on Wednesday nights. In some of the ministry circles I've been in, we use like cool lingo because it makes us feel cool. So one of the things people say is they'll be like, what's the hunger factor at your church right now? Like, are people hungry? And I'm like, you're making me hungry, but like, no, people ask that. I would say the hunger factor in our church right now is pretty good because there are 170 adults who are gathering here more together every day to flesh out Thomas-like belief. That's a good start. And we're going to avoid the Easter fizzle as we're doing that. You know what's going to happen is I think these adults, we're going to be filled with the Spirit. Because the great thing about filling with the Spirit, you do not have the words or you do not need to have the words to describe it for it to be happening. Right? You don't have to call it being filled with the Spirit for it to be happening in your life because it is way more about God than it is about us. And same thing with the mission. These adults, we're going to be about the mission, the proclamation of the forgiveness of sins in Jesus, because that proclamation is just as much for people already in the church as much as it is for people outside of the church. So we avoid the Easter fizzle by being filled with the Spirit, by being about the mission, and by believing like Thomas. One of the greatest privileges of my life so far has been being the student pastor here at Eagle. And I wanted to just brag on our students, you know, on the church's students, because they illustrate so well these three ideas. Being filled with the Spirit. There is a worship movement going on right now in our community that is student-led. It's called Gather. And students from here, from LCC, from Freedom Church, from New Hope Church, are gathering together on the weekend, putting their own worship nights together to sing, to lift praises to the Lord, to be filled with the Spirit. And all of us youth pastors are like, this is awesome. Don't touch it. We will mess it up if we touch it. So there's something going on there. I'm not sure. I don't think all the students would call it being filled with the Spirit, but if they keep earnestly seeking the Lord, that is what's going to happen. And then being about the mission. We have a lot of upperclassmen right now who are looking to go into full-time ministry, children's men, student men, worship men. And it's really encouraging for the youth pastor because we are a very insecure bunch. Like we will get real insecure, and it is at least encouraging to know I've not failed so badly that they think that what I do would be miserable. They actually, like, they might like it. But as exciting as that is, I would want our students to know that we need just as much, if not more, people who are willing to do what Coach Frank does, right? To be about the mission, not be in ministry. And I get to meet with these seniors who are literally weighing and praying through that. That's amazing. There was two upperclassmen of ours that a while back were having lunch at Zionsville High School. And there was a friend that they were interacting with. And for the first time, the person started to have some questions about faith, wanted to hear about what do they believe about Jesus. And so these two students start tag teaming. You know, like they have different giftings, so they're tag teaming and playing off of each other to share the gospel. The student keeps asking questions. But simultaneous to that, there are other students who are at those tables, and they are distracting them. They are shouting things, they are mocking them, they are teasing them. One student even picked up trash and threw it at one of our students. And this is in Zionsville High School, Churchtown land, you know? But our students, I think that had they not been being about the mission and being filled with the Spirit, that's the sort of stuff that will shut you down, right? Like you'd be like, oh, no thanks, never mind, that wasn't fun. But they persevered because they were not doing it in their own strength. And that Thomas-like belief, a lot of our adult volunteer leaders, they get to kind of see this play out in our small groups, right? Where students hopefully can find safe space to ask tough questions, to be real about what they are struggling with, to not feel like Christianity is some sanitized, squeaky, clean way of living. I love, there's four students that I meet with on Wednesday mornings for Bible study, and this week, one of them, after I'd asked a question and one student answered, he was like, I do not like your answer to the question, and I don't even like your question. I love that. That's great. That's what we should be doing. So how do we avoid the Easter fizzle? The Easter fizzle is going to come from choosing to do the wrong thing with a good thing. I think we all know what it is to have spiritual highs. And Easter is prime territory for spiritual highs. But most, if not all of us, also know what it is to fizzle out spiritually. So what is God speaking to you this morning? What is he inviting us into where we'll have a year full of things where we can say, only God? So I want to invite the worship team to start making their way up. I can tell you, at least as of now, what God has been speaking to me. The being filled with the Spirit. Like, that is what God has for me today and tomorrow and probably for a very long time. Because I have to confess to you all that, like, pastor title does nothing, right? So there is way too often times where I'm trying to go through my day in my own strength. Where I am not regularly praying and just asking, Lord, send your Spirit upon me to fill me and to empty myself. Like, that has not been happening enough. I have to own that. That has not really been prior past way of Ian's Christian living. But, like, getting into this and seeing, like, this is what Jesus invites us into. That is what the Lord I know has for me this morning. If you look at your notes and up on the screens, there's three questions that I wanted to pose to us. So first, we'll just read them. Do I need to invite the Spirit in and ask him to fill me? Do I need to take a next step to be more about the mission? Do I need to let go of expectations I have of God and be reconfronted with the living Christ? So those are our three questions. I do not know what God might be elevating in your own spirit and in your own life, of which one of those three is maybe really hitting home. But I wanted to try something maybe a little bit different. After the service is over, sometime this afternoon, tomorrow, Tuesday, my email address is in the bulletin. It's also going to be up on the screens. And I would love for people to just email me their name and the question that God was most speaking to them about. And part of that is simply to be able to specifically pray. But the other thing would be, you know, we can't get into always all the next steps in just the hour and 20 minutes together on Sunday. So, like, I would love to share with you resources. There's great books written by people about how do you pursue being filled with the Spirit. Or next steps. I can help connect you to some of the next steps of being on mission here at Eagle Church. I can help connect you with people who will not shame for asking questions and sharing doubts. Like, I would love to be a part of making that happen. So it would be amazing if, like, let's say we come back to work on Tuesday because Sabbath is Monday, and I'm like, Eric, I need 4 hours to respond to emails. Like, that would be an awesome thing. We just don't want the morning to pass us by, and as we as a church avoid and pray against the Easter fizzle, what are we going to do? So I want to invite you to close your eyes, bow your heads. And I want to just read these questions over us one more time. Do I need to invite the Spirit in and ask Him to fill me? Do I need to take a next step to be more about the mission? Do I need to let go of expectations I have of God and be reconfronted with the living God? Heavenly Father, thank you for what you did on Easter weekend. We cannot comprehend all of what you accomplished through your purpose. Lord, we acknowledge that you have a life that you want for us that is so filled with the Spirit, that is so in the way of Jesus' mission, and that is so just in the vein of genuine Thomas-like belief. So Lord, I pray for this church that we would be people who are known for proclaiming forgiveness. Lord, I pray that we would not fall into some rut where we can't point at things and say, only you. So Lord, we ask that as we respond in worship that you would do something in our lives. Give us the reminder to follow up, to follow through. Lord, we trust that your Spirit will do what only he can do. So we pray all of this in the name of Jesus, who is risen and who is our Lord and Savior. Amen. Please stand as we sing.
Of old, would you do it again? Do it again. All the stories told, all the miracles, would you do it again? Do it again. You said, consecrate yourselves to me. See amazing things. We need your revival, Holy Spirit fire burning ever brighter in our souls. Kings and kingdoms falling, hear your people calling. King of kings, we need a miracle. There's a time to sow and a time to reap. Would you do it again? Do it again. There's a time to heal and a time to mend. Would you do it again? Do it again. see amazing things. We need your revival, Holy Spirit fire, burning ever brighter in our souls. King and kingdoms falling, hear your people calling. King of kings, we need a miracle. Yes, we need your revival, Holy Spirit fire, burning ever brighter in our souls. Kings and kingdoms falling, hear your people calling. King of kings, we need a miracle. Among us, His glory surrounds us, His fire is falling as we sing, and the Savior is for us, and His love is victorious, and revival is rising in His name. Say it again, the King. And the King is among us. Surrounds us, and His fire is falling as we sing. And the Savior is for us, and His love is victorious, and the rival is rising in His name. The King is among us, and His glory surrounds us, and His fire.
Such an amazing morning. Thank you, God, for giving us the Sunday after Easter. God, I celebrate the words that Ian had to share, and I pray that we can noodle on those. We can take those into our work week, our school week, our family week. Jesus, thank you so much. Amen. Amen, everybody. So we've got one more song to do, and you know, worship is really, it's our response to things we value the most, that, you know, we're here worshiping God. One of the things that we do as part of our worship is we honor Him by giving back the gifts that He's given to us. It's so awesome to see everybody. If you're visiting with us here this morning, no obligation at all right now. But there are lots of, if you aren't visiting, there are lots of ways to give. I feel like that Easter video that we saw, because one of the other bullets is to make sure you put the Connect card in the basket if you filled it out. And you know, that's for real too. That's not just so that we can put you in a database. It is kind of cool because Michelle, our communications coordinator, she does really send out some great, great emails throughout the course of the week. So if you're not on it, you want to be on the list. Put your email address down. But you know, you can also, that's a great way to communicate. We have prayer teams that you can write on the communication card. You can anonymous, and you have people committed to praying for your situation. So if you want to expand the scope of that, then that's what this time is for, as well as just for us to say thank you, God, for being such an amazing blessing to us. So let's do that. Ushers, come ahead and come forward while we sing our last song.
Our God exchanges old for new, yeah.
stay standing for a second. There's a quick announcement that a couple of our upperclassmen wanted to share with you about something that is coming up for students next Sunday, May 5th. And so this is Esther, and then this is Evan, and they're going to share something with you guys.
All right, so like Ian just said, my name's Esther. This is Evan, and we are up here to announce an event that's coming up next week, May 5th, here at Eagle, called Students on the Night. And normally what this is it would be your high school student leadership team planning an evening for high school students, but we're doing it a little different this time. So this next week, Students on the Night is going to be for both middle school and high school. And it's related to what Ian talked about with the gather. So we're doing a gather here at Eagle. And so our invite is that your middle school students and your high school students would come to and be here at 6, and we'll hang out, we'll have community, and we'll worship. And Evan can tell you a little bit more about gather.
Yeah, I've been a part of gather since it started back in the fall. And basically what it is, it's about breaking down the barriers of the church buildings and fostering relationships between the people of the church, the true church. And so I've been a part of gather, and I can honestly say that it is some of the most worshipful and spirit-led moments that I've ever been a part of in my very obviously long life. But in all seriousness, it is really, truly something special, and I'm so grateful to be a part of it. So if you have anybody, middle school or high school, it'd be really great if they could come.
Absolutely. So that's next Sunday night. And then one final reminder that the Sicily Info Meeting will start at 11:45 a.m. today on that far side of the atrium. And so if you are prayerfully considering going to Sicily in the fall, we would love for you to go to that meeting. So for the benediction this morning, if you see at the end of John 20, there's kind of this purpose statement for the Gospel of John. It says, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. So while I encourage us to have a Thomas-like belief, there is something that is inherently different for us than for him. Thomas did get to see the living Lord, and we have not seen. So as we leave this place, go as people that believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Go as people who can have life to the full, life in his name. And hear the words of Jesus that says, blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed, which is every Christ follower in this room. So go in peace. You are loved.